I want to introduce to you one course on functional equations, but first I have a question. Have you ever heard of functional equations before? No? Do you want to know what functional equations are and what they are for? If you really want, this course will reveal not only what they are, but how much can be done with them. I invite you to travel this path with me, accompanied by these amazing equations. Functional equations are as powerful as differential equations, but unfortunately, they are not very well known. While it is common to have courses of differential equations among professionals in the mathematics, physics, and engineering fields, the counterpart of functional equations does not exist. With this course, we want to offer students the opportunity to know about this important field. We try to motivate the course using some very simple examples that illustrate the power of functional equations and provide a view of the possibilities that they offer to build models to reproduce the reality. When I discovered them, I was really surprised. In fact, I could not believe that this tool could be so simple and powerful. Since then, I started to see functional equations in many problems and apply them in many occasions. My motivation arises from this extremely positive experience and is pushed by the pleasure of sharing with others what we think it is worthwhile to share. Thus, I invite you to travel with me in this experience.
For you to understand what functional equations are, I am going to give a simple example. If I ask you about the formula for the area of a rectangle, probably you will tell me it is the basis times the height. I am sorry to tell you that this is not the right answer. We will see. Suppose we don't know the formula for the area of a rectangle, but we know that it is a function f of the basis b and the height h. Then we need to determine what function corresponds to the right answer. To this end, we are going to impose two conditions. The first one is the following. Assume we divide the rectangle horizontally in two small rectangles, one in yellow and one in white, and then I express that the area of the initial rectangle is equal to the sum of the areas of the other two rectangles. Then I use the function to do that. The first rectangle, that is the initial one, the area is f of b h1 plus h2, because b is the basis and h1 plus h2 is the height. And the other rectangles have areas that are f of b h1, the white one, and f of b h2, the yellow one. Then I write an equation, which is that the area of the first rectangle is the sum of the areas of the other two. Next, what I do is I divide the rectangle vertically in two rectangles, the blue one and the white one now, and I express the same condition. The area of the initial rectangle has to be equal to the sum of the areas of the other two rectangles, and then I obtain another equation like that. As a summary, I have two equations because I have two equalities and only one unknown. So this is a system of two functional equations in one unknown. The unknown is the f function. I am going to tell you that the only solution for this system is the function f of bh, which is equal to c bh. That is, we don't get b times h, we get c times b times h. And c is a constant. And what is the meaning of this constant? The meaning of this constant is that if the basis is given in inches, the height is given in feet, and I want the area in square kilometers, then I need to correct the dimensions and then I need the c. It is very interesting to see that the functional equation reveals something that perhaps we have never thought.
This was one of my first surprises with functional equations. The fact that these equations made me realize that if the base of a rectangle is in feet, the height in meters, and the area is wanted in square kilometers, the formula learned in the school must be corrected by a constant c, which serves to correct the units used. This caught my attention because I never thought that the most general formula of the area of a rectangle was other than what we all knew and used from school. Even more,
Any mathematical, physical, or engineering formula, including dimensional variables, must contain these constants of change of scale and some of them also a change of origin. Our second example is the area of a trapezoid. Similarly, if I ask you what is the formula that gives the area of a trapezoid, probably you will answer the product of the semi-sum of its bases times its height. However, this is not the correct answer. Based on the formula for the area of a rectangle, can you guess the correct answer? As before, we assume that the formula of the trapezoidal area is a function of the lengths of its bases, b1 and b2, and its height h as indicated in the box formula. Though people will expect the formula to be the product of the semi-sum of its bases times its height, we will see that this is not the case. To obtain the formula of the area of a trapezoid, we will do the following. First, we divide the trapezoid into two trapezoids. Second, we consider the special case of a rectangle. And third, we change the trapezoid scale. Finally, we will see that these three properties together will provide us with the correct formula. First, we consider the trapezoid divided into two trapezoids. Though we cannot calculate the areas of the three trapezoids, we can write them in terms of the function f and the corresponding bases and height, as shown in the transparency. The reader must check that they are effectively the right expressions. Finally, forcing the area of the initial rectangle to be equal to the sum of the areas of the two trapezoids, we obtain the functional equations in the transparency. Second, we consider the rectangle as a particular case of trapezoid and divide it vertically into two rectangles. Next, we write the areas of the initial rectangle and the two rectangles in white and blue colors in terms of the function f and the corresponding bases and heights, as shown in the figure. Next, we again write that the area of the initial rectangle, which is a trapezoid, is equal to the sum of the areas of the other two rectangles, which also are trapezoid, and get the functional equation in the transparency. Finally, we change the trapezoid scale by a factor s, write the areas of the two trapezoids in terms of the function f and their bases and heights, and express that the area of the new trapezoid is equal to s squared times the area of the initial trapezoid. With this, we obtain this system of three functional equations with a single unknown function f. It can be demonstrated that the only continuous function in the box, where k1 and k2 are arbitrary constants, satisfies the system of equations above. For the particular case of k1 equal to 1, k2 equal to 1/2, we obtain the well-known formula, the area is the semi-sum of its bases times its height. These three equations' properties together permit us to obtain, characterize the area of a trapezoid formula. Based on the two formulas, I invite you to justify why we need two constants and why one is not.
A second example is the case of the sum of the internal angles of a polygon. If we want to obtain the formula for the sum of the internal angles of a polygon, what we can do is we can split one of the sides in two, and then we compare the sum of the angles of the previous polygon with the sum of the internal angles with the new polygon, and we see that the only difference is that only three angles change value. Two of them change the value, increasing by alpha and beta, and another one is a new one which has a value gamma. But these angles correspond to a triangle. So the sum of the angles of the new polygon is the previous sum plus the sum of a triangle. So we can write that f of n plus 1, that is when we add another side, is equal to f of n, which is the one in the previous case, plus f of 3, which is a constant and which is known to be the pi number. So it's 180 degrees. Then we solve this functional equation and we obtain the well-known formula, which is f of n equal to pi times n minus.
Next, we deal with the formula for the simple interest. Let f be a function of x and t, the interest we receive from the bank after a deposit of an amount x during a period of duration t. Then, if the assumptions of single interest hold, the function f must satisfy the following conditions. At the end of the time period t, we receive the same interest in the following two cases. See the figure. First, we deposit the amount x plus y in one account. And two, we deposit the amount x in one account and the amount y in another account, as it is illustrated in the figures. If we express that both interests must be the same, we get the indicated functional equation, where the function f is the only unknown. At the end of the time period t plus u, we receive the same amount in the following two cases. See the figure. First, we deposit the amount x during a period of duration t plus u, and second, we deposit the amount x first during a period of duration t, and later the received amount for a period of duration u, as illustrated in the figures. Writing that both interests must be identical, we get the indicated functional equation. Thus, we get the system of two functional equations. The first equation is a family of Cauchy equations with index t. Thus, its general solution is the one in the transparency, where the C constant becomes a function of t, one for each t value. Replacing this solution into the second equation and removing the common x, assuming to be non-zero, we get another Cauchy equation with the indicated solution, which replaced back leads to the well-known simple interest formula that says that we receive an amount equal to the interest rate k times the deposit x times the time t. We give now a very interesting interpretation of the simple interest formula. First, we know that the bank policy has to be such that the return amount when depositing an amount x plus y during a period t in one account must be greater than the sum of the return interest corresponding to depositing in two accounts x and y during the same period duration t, because otherwise the bank is inviting its clients to deposit their money in many accounts, a low amount in each account, in order to get more benefits. Similarly, we must have that the return amount when depositing an amount x during a period of duration t plus u must be greater or equal than the return amount when the deposit is separated into two periods of duration t plus u. Otherwise, the bank is inviting its clients to withdraw the money every day and deposit it again. Consequently, simple interest is the optimal way of keeping account stability by giving the least possible interest. Fortunately, the actual bank policy does not follow the simple interest rule. It is important to note here that the above assumptions do not hold in reality, but they are the simple interest assumptions. It can be seen from the bank office that if we deposit a larger amount or we do so for a longer period, the interest rate increases. A comparison of the system of equations corresponding to the case of the rectangle area given above and of the system of equations associated with the simple interest example shown below shows that apart from notation the two systems of functional equations are identical. This means that we have two physical problems, one geometric and one economic, leading to exactly the same mathematical model. It is interesting to point out that the commutativity of the base b and height h in the rectangle area results as a consequence of the assumptions, but it is not axiomatic. This implies that a rectangle can be rotated an angle of pi divided by 2 radians, exchange base and height, without changing its area. The commutativity also holds for the simple interest case, that is, we get the same interest if we deposit $1 for 2 years as if we deposit $2 for 1 year. Next, we consider the compound interest formula. Assume that f of xt is the amount you receive after a period of duration t when you deposit a capital X at the beginning of the period in a given saving account. The function f of xt must be increasing in both arguments and must satisfy some conditions. Some possible conditions are: the first condition states the fact that the return final amount depends only on the total initial investment and not on the number of investments it can be divided to. In fact, it states this property for only two investments, as indicated by the first functional equation. The second condition states the fact that the final amount depends only on the total time t plus u. The capital is deposited and known on how it is divided to, as indicated by the second functional equation. Of course, these two assumptions can be questioned, but they are classical assumptions used everywhere. It is interesting to point out the three following important facts. If the first constraint holds, we get more if we cancel the actual deposit and initiate a new one by reinvestment. If the second condition holds, we are invited to make many small investments instead of a single one for the whole amount. Finally, if the inequalities in I and 2 are reversed, the bank is offering more than necessary. Thus, under this point of view, the bank offer corresponds to the inequalities in the above expressions. These conditions lead to a system of functional equations for the compound interest. The first equation above is a family of Cauchy equations. Thus, assuming continuity with respect to x, its solution is given by the formula below, where c of t is an arbitrary increasing positive function of t. Substitution into the second equation leads to the indicated equation, which is a Pexidler equation, and assuming continuity with respect to t leads to c of t equal to qt, where q is equal to 1 plus r, and r, greater than 0, is a constant larger than 1, but otherwise arbitrary. Since both interests must be the same, we get the final formula, which is the well-known compound interest formula. We wish to point out here that other interest formulas do not satisfy these two assumptions. In this lesson, we have motivated functional equations using very simple examples that show the reader how they can be used to solve real problems. We have discovered that formulas that we were using for a very long time can be interpreted in a more general way, that is, in which we combine different units of measure for each variable. Those simple and almost trivial examples, such as the rectangle and the trapezoid, they have revealed us a different point of view which we probably have not imagined previously. The examples of interest have also revealed us interesting properties which we had never thought of before. I invite you to follow the next lesson dedicated to some classical functional equations, in which we will see interesting functional equations and some applications.